When you go to the Natural History Museum and you see all the fossils, most of us are like, wow, look at all those fossils. And yeah, the museum probably has a bunch of neat stuff on display, but those rows of bones aren't the whole story. See, most of the fossils in the world are missing. Or to be precise, most of the fossils never existed in the first place. And that's a problem for people who want to use them to discover the secrets of the ancient past. So here's how researchers are solving the world's biggest jigsaw puzzle when like 90% of the pieces are missing. To start, let's talk about how to make a fossil. Step one, dye. That's kind of the easy part since everybody's got to go sometime. The trickier bit is the switch from a dead thing to a fossil of a dead thing. And the best way to do that is for your dead thing to get buried. Now, our writer pointed out that technically you can be buried first and die second, but that's not nice to think about. So we'll just ignore that for now. Okay, so the body of an organism becomes buried in some kind of sediment. It could be the sand on a beach or the mud at the bottom of a lake, anything that will cover up the body and seal it away from the wind and rain and scavengers. Once they're underground, the organic remains gradually break down and react with the surrounding minerals. Eventually, the original materials become filled in and replaced with mineral components. This is how we get most of our famous fossils, like dinosaur bones, shark teeth, and ammonite shells. Those fossils are essentially rocks, made up of some combination of original material and minerals from the surrounding sediment. And they were kind of halfway to being rocks even when they were alive. Bones are mostly calcium, so when they get buried, the porous sections can fill in with other minerals. And a shell is just a hunk of calcium carbonate, so it's most of the way towards being a rock already. There are other things that can be fossils too, of course. An insect can be preserved in amber, for example, or a leaf can get squashed between rock layers and preserved as a carbon film. But all of these modes of fossilization follow a pretty similar pattern. Get buried and get preserved in rock. The study of fossilization is called taphonomy. It's basically the study of everything that happens between when an organism dies and when somebody finds it as a fossil, if it was one of the lucky ones. See, researchers know that not all organisms have equal odds of fossilizing. This is called preservation bias, and it can make a big difference in how we see these ancient ecosystems. For example, trilobites are super famous fossils. These ancient ocean bugs had hard exoskeletons and spent a lot of their lives crawling around on the muddy seafloor. They're practically custom made to be turned into gorgeous fossils. But most of their fellow sea creatures were small, squishy swimmers that would almost certainly be destroyed before they ever made it to burial and mineralization. So while the fossil record is full of trilobites, researchers think that between 80 to 90% of the ancient marine species that have ever lived never fossilized at all. Now, this sounds like a bummer, but preservation bias isn't quite as bad as it sounds. The fact that we know about preservation bias means that paleontologists have a pretty good idea of what factors are tipping the scales. Like we said before, hard parts like bones, shells, and wood are super durable, so they're much more likely to survive the ravages of weather and decomposition long enough to be buried, at least somewhat intact. On the other hand, softer body parts like organs, feathers, and flowers tend to break down before they ever had a chance to turn rock solid. Size matters too. The gigantic bone of a T-Rex will tend to survive the full process much better than the delicate little bones of a mouse. But it isn't just the organism's bodies that affect their odds of mineralizing. The environment itself can have an impact. To make a really good fossil, the best kind of environment is one that has consistent, gentle buildup of sediment over time. It also helps if it's cold, dark, and has low oxygen levels to keep decay from happening. So if you were trying to pick the ideal environment for fossil making, something like the bottom of a deep lake couldn't get much better. On the other hand, your odds of finding fossils from times and places that have harsh weather, temperature fluctuations, or just don't build up sediment layers are basically nil. So if you're a paleontologist searching for ancient squishy worms that lived on mountain slopes, you might want to consider a career change. Preservation bias is a problem, but it's not a new problem, and yet solving it has been way harder than we'd hoped. The more we study fossils and fossilization, the more we realize just how complicated it can be to figure out exactly who is missing from the fossil record. Like, you might expect that similar animals buried in the same environment would probably fossilize equally well, but it turns out that's not necessarily true. A 2025 study conducted an experiment where they closely monitored the decomposition process of a variety of ocean animals. They found that the rate of decomposition not only depended on the animal's size and squishiness, but also on the different types of molecules that made up their tissues. And as each animal's body decomposed in slightly different ways, the chemical reaction of decomposition affected how much oxygen was sucked out of the surrounding water. And when oxygen levels change, it could affect the ability of decomposing microbes to break down the body. All this means that a small squishy shrimp and small squishy worm that died side by side might have different fossilization potential just because of what molecules make up their bodies. And it gets weirder. Some other studies have found that certain factors we thought were universally bad for fossilization can sometimes actually make it more likely for something to fossilize. Take scavengers, for instance. It makes sense that if scavengers find a carcass, they'll get in the way of fossilization because they'll chow down and destroy the body and not leave much to preserve. But in some cases, it looks like scavengers might actually help the preservation process. A 2022 study examined an extraordinary fossil of a dinosaur called Edmontosaurus. This was so well preserved that researchers even found patches of skin on its legs and tail, making it a dinosaur mummy. It was in such good shape that paleontologists have assumed that this lucky dino must have been buried incredibly quickly, and scavengers didn't have a chance to snack on it. But when they looked closely at the preserved skin, they found signs of damage from teeth and claws. This prompted them to examine scavenging behavior in modern animals to see if they were missing something. They found that when scavengers dig into a carcass, they usually start with the soft flesh and organs, which is gross. But to get to those tasty bits, the scavengers end up opening holes in the body that can release the various fluids and gases and microbes of decomposition into the outside world. Scavenger activity also removes a lot of the decomposers from the body, giving the remaining tissues, such as skin, a better chance of surviving, drying out, and becoming buried and fossilized. So in the case of that Edmontosaurus mummy, getting picked over by scavengers might have been the key to fossilizing so beautifully. And speaking of scavengers, we also know that sometimes the things that an animal did during its life affect its odds of fossilization down to its favorite meal. Take, for example, the famous La Brea tar pits of California. There, paleontologists have uncovered hundreds of fossils of mammoths, ground sloths, and more from the end of the Ice Age. These animals all stepped into patches of sticky asphalt and became stuck like flies on flypaper, eventually becoming buried and fossilized. But while there's plenty of fossils of those other animals, saber-toothed cats and direwolves outnumber them almost 10 to 1 by some estimates. Literally thousands have been uncovered, which is way more than any of the herbivores at the site. That's an unusual ratio. In living ecosystems and at fossil sites, herbivores tend to be much more abundant than carnivores. Think of the size of African lion prides compared to African zebra herds. And that makes sense, because if you had more carnivores than herbivores, there just wouldn't be enough food to go around unless they started eating other carnivores. But La Brea is different, because those tar pits acted as a predator trap. A mammoth or sloth would get stuck in the asphalt and become easy pickings for hungry carnivores. Then some cats or wolves would go to snack on it and, oops, oh no, now they're stuck too. So tar pits are a great place for finding fossil predators, but that also means that the fossils we find in the pits aren't as good of a snapshot of the whole ecosystem as we'd hoped. And on top of all that, even when we've accounted for the variations in ancient environments and body types, we can still end up with a skewed record because of one of the most classic dilemmas of science: human error. Two different studies from 2019 found there's a sex bias in museum collections of mammals and birds. In collections of both modern and fossil species, males were significantly more common than females. Now, that might make sense for the living things, since males of bird and mammal species also tend to be bigger and flashier than females, making the living ones more likely to catch the attention of collectors. But why would this be true for fossils, too? Part of this might be our own human impulses. When museums build their collections, they might want to acquire the really exceptional fossils, and that often means the biggest. And since for a lot of vertebrate species, males are bigger than females, well, you get it. And what's really interesting is that this bias might not be all our fault. Some of it could be due to the animal's behavior. In many species, males tend to be more solitary, more wide-ranging, and more prone to risky behavior, which means that males might be predisposed to ending up trapped in a tar pit. So all in all, there are 1,000 reasons that the fossils we've collected provide an incomplete vision of the distant past. Some species are overrepresented, and others are hardly represented at all. It's a pretty big problem, but there are plenty of science-based solutions. For one thing, there are lots of different types of fossils, and they can complement each other. Where one type of evidence is missing, others can help fill in the gaps. A study from early in 2025 identified fossil footprints of club-tailed dinosaurs called ankylosaurs from fossil sites dating to the mid-Cretaceous period of Western Canada, which is cooler than it sounds, because we don't actually have any of their bones from that place and time. So while we don't know what caused this particular preservation bias, the footprints alone help us fill in the gaps left by unequal fossilization. We can go back to the very earliest life forms on Earth, too. Those tiny microbes had a very low chance of becoming fossilized because they were, you know, tiny. But while their bodies are gone, they left traces of their existence in the form of lipids, molecules of fat that tell us there were living things there once upon a time. Scientists can also compare ancient environments to modern ones and try to use what's around today to estimate what's missing. Basically, you count up the number of species of all your different categories in a modern ecosystem, and you can use the relative ratios to estimate what might be missing in the fossil ecosystem. That's obviously never going to be perfect, and you need to be really careful with the example ecosystem, but it's a start. Or you can go further and try to figure out population sizes for extinct animals based on what we know about present ones. A 2021 study identified a relationship between body size and population size in living animals and used that correlation to estimate population sizes of Tyrannosaurus rex. Their calculations predicted that around 20,000 adult T-Rex would have existed at any given time, and during the species' entire tenure on our planet, there would have been around 2.5 billion individuals stomping around. Which is, of course, way more than the number of T-Rex fossils we've ever found. As of this video, there's like 30. Naturally, there's probably a big margin of error on these estimates, given how many variables are involved. But it's still a cool concept for how we could take modern populations and use them to decipher things about the past. And beyond all those tricks of the trade, the best way to get around the issue of an incomplete fossil record is to keep studying the fossilization process itself. Paleontologists are constantly discovering new quirks and details about the ways that organisms preserve in the geological record. Each new discovery brings us closer to understanding exactly how biased our fossil record is and how to fill in those gaps. Sadly, there are loads of ancient species that we'll simply never know about, and we'll never find a perfectly preserved fossil ecosystem. But researchers are able to piece together the past in quite a bit of detail by understanding the fossils that aren't there as much as the ones that are.